I guess you didn't hear me. Good morning.
Good morning.
There we go. Praise the Lord. I'm very excited. It's a beautiful day. A few days ago, something real nice happened. My chickens are finally going inside on their own. I don't have to pick them up anymore and put them inside the coop. Anyway, that's besides the point. Just thought it was funny. I want to share something with you that I was thinking about last night when I was asking the Lord, what should I talk about this morning? I've been thinking a lot about Myron because he's going through a very difficult time. And, you know, it's very heartbreaking to see him suffering the way he is and the desperation that he has, you know, just waiting for the manifestation of the healing that he so desperately desires. And when I was thinking about that and I was asking God what to show me what to speak about this morning, he put two things in my heart. The first thing that I heard was, believe in the Lord Jesus Christ and you will be saved, you and your household. And the second thing that I heard that he put in my heart was, in this world you will have tribulation, but be of good cheer, I have overcome the world. So I want to read to you from those two scriptures. John, I'm going to start with John chapter 16, and I'm going to read the whole chapter, so please bear with me. It says, I have said all these things to you to keep you from falling away. They will put you out of the synagogues. Indeed, the hour is coming when whoever kills you will think he is offering service to God. And they will do these things because they have not known the Father nor me. But I have said these things to you that when their hour comes, you may remember that I told them to you. I did not say these things to you from the beginning because I was with you. But now I am going to him who sent me, and none of you asked me, where are you going? But because I said these things to you, sorrow has filled your heart. Nevertheless, I tell you the truth. It is to your advantage that I go away, for if I do not go away, the Helper will not come to you. I want to pause there because I want to interject something here. Before Jesus came, all of the things that happened to all these mighty men in the Bible happened because they believe God and they have faith in him. So that was a covenant at that time. Then God made himself man to dwell among us. And then after the crucifixion, the fulfillment of his purpose on this earth, now we enter into the new covenant in which we acquire the Holy Spirit. Okay, nevertheless, I tell you the truth. It is to your advantage that I go away, for if I do not go away, the Helper will not come to you. But if I go, I will send him to you. And when he comes, he will convict the world concerning sin and righteousness and judgment. Concerning sin, because they do not believe in me. Concerning righteousness, because I go to the Father, and you will see me no longer. Concerning judgment, because the ruler of this world is judged. I still have many things to say to you, but you cannot bear them now. When the Spirit of truth comes, he will guide you into all the truth, for he will not speak on his own authority, but whatever he hears, he will speak, and he will declare to you the things that are to come. He will glorify me, for he will take what is mine and declare it to you. All that the Father has is mine. Therefore, I said that he will take what is mine and declare it to you. A little while, and you will see me longer. And again, a little while, and you will see me. So some of his disciples said to one another, what is this that he says to us? A little while, and you will not see me. And again, a little while, and you will see me. And because I am going to the Father. So they were saying, what does he mean by a little while? We do not know what he is talking about. Jesus knew that they wanted to ask him, so he said to them, "Is this what you are asking yourselves? What I meant by saying, 'A little while and you will not see me, and again a little while and you will see me'? Truly, truly, I say to you, you will weep and lament, but the world will rejoice. You will be sorrowful, but your sorrow will turn into joy. When a woman is given birth, she has sorrow because her hour has come. But when she has delivered the baby, she no longer remembers the anguish for joy that a human being has been born into the world." This is very fascinating to me that he uses this particular analogy, because it's very true. You know, when a woman goes into labor, she's experiencing probably the most intense pain she can experience in her life. And the moment that that baby's born, it goes away like this, and this big smile comes to their face. So it's very fascinating how, at least to me, how he's using this analogy to explain this, that you know, the world is going to rejoice when the worst thing that can happen to him is going to happen, which is that he's going to die. It says, "So also you have sorrow now, but I will see you again, and your hearts will rejoice, and no one will take your joy from you. In the day you will ask nothing of me. In that day you will ask nothing of me. Truly, truly, I say to you, whatever you ask of the Father in my name, he will give it to you. Until now you have asked nothing in my name. Ask, and you will receive, that your joy may be full. I have said these things to you in figures of speech. The hour is coming when I will no longer speak to you in figures of speech, but will tell you plainly about the Father. In that day you will ask in my name, and I do not say to you that I will ask the Father on your behalf. For the Father himself loves you, because you have loved me and have believed that I came from God. I came from the Father and have come into the world, and now I am leaving the world and going to the Father." His disciples said, "Ah, now you are speaking plainly and not using figurative speech. Now we know that you know all things and do not need anyone to question you. This is why we believe that you came from God." Jesus answered them, "Do you now believe? Behold, the hour is coming. Indeed, it has come when you will be scattered, each to his own home, and will leave me alone. Yet I am not alone, for the Father is with me. I have said these things to you, that in me you may have peace. In the world you will have tribulation, but take heart, I have overcome the world." So I'm thinking about this, and I'm thinking about what Myron is going through. So I'm trying to figure out how am I going to put these two things together. And as I continue to listen, what I heard was, before, the covenant was purely of faith. The Holy Spirit wasn't in the midst because he had not come yet. But now that Jesus was crucified and he resurrected, we enter into this new covenant, and now we have his Spirit and we can operate within that. So we're going to go through difficult situations, and here's a clear example in Acts chapter 16, which is the other thing that I heard. It starts in verse 16, and notice John 16, Acts 16, verse 16. "As we were going to the place of prayer, we were met by a slave girl who had a spirit of divination and brought her owners much gain by fortune telling. She followed Paul and us, crying out, 'These men are servants of the Most High God who proclaim to you the way of salvation.' And this she kept doing for many days. Paul, having become greatly annoyed, turned and said to the spirit, 'I command you in the name of Jesus Christ to come out of her.' And it came out that very hour." He just spoke the word in Jesus' name, and the spirit came out. "But when her owners saw that their hope of gain was gone, they seized Paul and Silas and dragged them into the marketplace before the rulers. And when they had brought them to the magistrates, they said, 'These men are Jews, and they are disturbing our city. They advocate customs that are not lawful for us as Romans to accept and practice. The crowd joined in attacking them, and the magistrates tore the garments off them and gave orders to beat them with rods. And when they had inflicted many blows upon them, they threw them into prison, ordering the jailer to keep them safely. Having received this order, he put them into the inner prison and fastened their feet in the stocks. So they were beaten and thrown in prison. They're going through the trial. About midnight, Paul and Silas were praying and singing hymns to God. You notice how it doesn't say that they were complaining. They were still worshiping God in the midst of it. And the prisoners were listening to them. And suddenly, there was a great earthquake, so that the foundations of the prison were shaken. And immediately all the doors were opened, and everyone's bonds were unfastened. When the jailer woke and saw that the prison doors were open, he drew his sword and was about to kill himself, supposing that the prisoners had escaped. But Paul cried with a loud voice, "Do not harm yourself, for we are all here. And the jailer called for lights and rushed in, and trembling with fear, he fell down before Paul and Silas. Then he brought them out and said, "Sirs, what must I do to be saved?" And they said, "Believe in the Lord Jesus, and you will be saved, you and your household." And they spoke the word of the Lord to him and to all who were in his house. And he took them the same hour of the night and washed their wounds. And he was baptized at once, he and all his family. Then he brought them up into his house and set food before them. And he rejoiced along with his entire household that he had believed in God. But when it was day, the magistrates sent the police, saying, let those men go. And the jailer reported these words to Paul, saying, "The magistrates have sent to let you go. Therefore, come out now and go in peace." But Paul said to them, "They have beaten us publicly, uncondemned, men who are Roman citizens, and have thrown us into prison. And do they now throw us out secretly? No. Let them come themselves and take us out." The police reported these words to the magistrates, and they were afraid when they heard that they were Roman citizens. So they came and apologized to them, and they took them out and asked them to leave the city. So they went out of the prison and visited Lydia, and when they had seen the brothers, they encouraged them and departed. So Paul and Silas went through this trial. They were beaten, they were thrown into jail, yet they just sat there praying and singing hymns, worshiping God, continuing to believe that God was going to move. What happened? The earth shook, the prison gates were open, but they just stayed there. So because of this, the jailer was so dumbfounded that he said, "What do I do? Believe in Jesus and you will be saved." And as a result of this, he believed, and then he was blessed. He got baptized. He became a follower. And Paul and Silas were blessed too, because they had their wounds healed and they had food on the table and all those things. So God delivered them. So the point that I'm trying to make is this. The covenant that we have now is so much powerful than the one from before. And all we have to do is speak those words into our lives, into others' lives. And I know that what Myron is going through right now is going to look like a little pebble compared to the manifestation of God's glory that he's going to have. But we have to join him into his need and stand with him and continue to declare that word. And God's going to do all these great and wonderful things that we are so much expecting. Amen. Prayer requests, testimonies, anything to share? James.
Problem in there that we just wouldn't be able to do this thing.
Yes, Carol.
I would like prayer for a cousin's right arm. He gets gout in the weirdest places.
All right. Yes.
We have a good friend who's going to have surgery tomorrow for breast cancer, and I pray for her complete healing and a successful surgery.
Yes.
Good faith to just thank God through this trial.
Amen.
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 Yes.
We were talking on the way over here about the individual we know, that, and I'm sure all of us know people like this. Everything that happens to them is God's will. And I told Jane, I said, well, if you believe that, then there would be absolutely no reason whatsoever to pray.
That's right.
Because it wouldn't change anything.
Mm-hmm.
If that is God's will,
right,
then what will do you have against that?
Yeah.
So that's how ridiculous, and yet all of us, I'm sure, have run into people and know people that believe.
Mm.
Anytime something happens, they say, well, you know, somebody gets cancer, somebody does it, they just accept it. Now, well, that's God's will, you know. That was never God's will.
That's right.
But even whatever happens, He has given us dominion over the situation.
What?
We better get a hold of that and understand we have dominion.
Yeah, exactly.
The other night, I don't even know what night it was. When you retire, it's six Saturdays and Sunday. So to get a day out there doesn't matter. They're all the same. But it was one night, Jane had gone to bed, and I was laying there, and I've run into this spirit before, and I feel it. I mean, I could just feel it coming in, and I wasn't sure what tidings it was bearing, but it was not good, you know. And but the Lord impressed on me again that we have dominion over all those spirits. Now, you not only have to know that, you got to believe it.
That's right.
You've got to get that buried into here. And the Lord dealt with me on another thing, is that since He has given us dominion, we are to confront these things.
Yes.
Right.
You know, we always want to drag Him into the equation. He's there all the time. He's in us.
Yeah.
Exactly.
But He said, you will cast out devils.
Right. Right.
You will heal the sick.
Right.
You will raise the dead. Why did He say you? If we're not have that ability to, you know, He was moved with compassion. He saw things that it moved Him. We should be too.
Exactly.
And when it moves us, we should have the faith to speak to that situation with authority.
Amen.
As one that has dominion.
Amen.
And I think until we all get that buried inside and understand it, when we do get it like we should have it, we should be able to face any situation. I don't care what happens. And then the Lord will bring dreams to you that these situations occur in dreams. You ever notice that? You're in a situation where you need faith, where you need to do things, and you have it. And then you wake up and you're like perplexed. And I believe God is showing you
right in
a dream exactly what reality is.
Exactly.
And we need to get a hold of that and say, whoa, whoa, there is no difference.
No.
We move from that dimension into this dimension. That's what the Lord's showing us. In dreams, He shows us this is situation. You go in, I had this crazy dream I told Jane. Always dark, pitch black, goes back when you're a kid. And I'm going down this hall and I feel this power trying to pull me into the bathroom at the end of the hall. And there's a light right there, and I'm turning it on. Of course, it doesn't work. It's pitch dark. I finally go into the bathroom. And I'm expecting that Satan himself's in there, you know. And all of a sudden, this blew my mind. My hands went up, and I went up through the bathroom ceiling. some entity that is more powerful than my faith. He said, no, you won't, because it's me that's in there. I'll take you. I'll be with you. And I don't know, the older I get, the crazier I get. I have these dreams that are absolutely mind-blowing, but I know they have meaning.
Yes.
You know, these things that we speak over our lives and the lives of others, that we do so with the authority that we have. I had a conversation with someone not too long ago, and this person told me that my optimism sets unrealistic expectations, and I'm setting myself for disappointment. And I disagree with that, because some people think that a miracle is seeing a dead person come back to life, or something completely disappear, something that you can perceive through your senses. My miracles have all been internal, and all the things that I have experienced and God has done in my life have been beyond my expectations. Granted, some things that I was wanting to happen did not happen the way I wanted them, but I'm not sad. I wasn't destroyed, because He continued to lift me up, which is why I know that my optimism sets realistic expectations, because He says that we're going to have an abundant life.
Yes.
And we can expect for Him to do anything that our minds can come up with and more. So,
amen.
Sheila.
She
whole behalf.
Yep.
He's going to church with her this morning, so you know that somehow during all of this, that God will really, really get a hold of him, you know, just once and for all, really, really help this boy to get some revelation of of what a real change means.
Yes.
Yesterday, there was a boom, 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 boom outside my house, and about 10 minutes later, I had Leah, and we had been out walking. I thought, well, I'm going to see what this is, so I went and saw some neighbors, and they says, I think firecrackers. Well, lo and behold, here comes cops and blocking off our street, and there's bullets laying just right outside our house almost, or just looking, and one neighbor did see a car and a truck, and he said they were squealing their tires, and he thought it was fireworks going off, but it was actually a gunshot, and gunshots going off. We just never know who's in the next car or right beside us, you know? It's kind of dangerous, I guess, but I thank the Lord that we were inside at that moment. The Lord kept us safe, and, you know, that he just continues to watch over his people.
Yes.
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 Amen.
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 Stand. And let's come to the Lord this morning. Father, we thank you for bringing us here to be gathered in your name. We thank you, Lord, for all of the word and testimonies that have been shared, Father. All the prayer requests that have been brought to you, Lord, we put them all in your hands, and we know that you will take care of our every need. We thank you, Father, for the protection that you give us, for being with us always, reminding us of who you are and what you can do for us. We thank you, Father, for the promises that you made, the promise of healing that some in your body are so desperately seeking right now. We ask, Lord, that you manifest in those situations and that your healing takes place, Lord. That your Spirit, Holy Spirit, the Comforter, comforts those hearts and take away all anxieties from your people. We bring those to you, Father, that are undergoing some sort of procedure or medical treatment, Father, that you continue to protect them, that your mighty hands over that situation and everything happens according to your will and purpose. We thank you, Lord, for being so good to us. We thank you for giving us the expectation that we know that whatever it is that you do in our lives can surpass whatever our wildest dreams are. We thank you, Father, because you bring us together to share your word, that we know that no matter what situation we face, Lord, we can pray to you and worship you, and you're always there moving in that situation, and you will get us out. We thank you, Father, for loving us the way that you do, for giving your only Son to come and die for our sins so that a new covenant would be formed, a covenant that now gives us access to you. Thank you, Heavenly Father, for giving us your Holy Spirit to guide us, to steer us back into the path that you have laid in front of us, Lord, for us to continue to fulfill the purpose that you have given us, that you have for our lives. Thank you, Heavenly Father, for giving us the boldness to speak your word into our lives and the lives of others into any situation, knowing that your word will produce what it says it will produce. Thank you, Heavenly Father, for manifesting in this place today and for bringing forth your word and the revelation through your Holy Spirit. We are expecting, Lord, that you will do great and wonderful things. That anything that we ask in Jesus' name, we shall receive.
Thank you, Jesus.
All right. We're in fast forward mode. Okay, turn your cell phones off, please. Now that we took care of that, let's speak the word. Will you not revive us again, that your people may rejoice in you? I am a believer, and these signs do follow me. In the name of Jesus, I cast out demons. I speak in new tongues. I lay hands on the sick, and they too recover. Christ has redeemed me from the curse of the law. Therefore, I forbid any sickness or disease to come upon this body. Every disease, germ, and every virus that touches this body dies instantly in the name of Jesus. Every organ and every tissue of this body functions to the perfection to which God created it to function. And I forbid any malfunction in this body in the name of Jesus. I receive the spirit of wisdom and revelation in the knowledge of him, the eyes of my understanding being enlightened. And I am not conformed to this world, but am transformed by the renewing of my mind. My mind is renewed by the word of God. The Lord rebukes the devourer for my sake, and no weapon that is formed against my finances will prosper. All obstacles and hindrances to my financial prosperity are now dissolved. The Lord has pleasure in the prosperity of his servant, and Abraham's blessings are mine. John, would you mind?
Love that guides our every step, Lord, when we
said, and we just come together this morning, Lord, to rejoice in you. We take up this offering in your name that you bless us, we pray. The glory of your namesake, your kingdom, your church, and this morning's service, your anointing on the word. We thank you for that, Lord. We just give you the praise in the holy name of Jesus. Amen.
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 Praise the Lord.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
Praise God. Thank you, Jesus. Praise God. Amen. Let's thank the Lord right now for what he's done and what he's doing. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord. It is finished in Jesus' name. Praise God. Your word is a final word, Lord, in every situation, over every circumstance. We declare it to be the truth, the final word. In Jesus' name, praise God. Praise God. Thank you, Jesus. Glory to God. Give him a hand this morning. Praise God. Praise God. Praise God. Amen. Praise God. Thank you, Roberto. Thank you, Mike and worship team. Thank you, all of you, for sharing your testimonies and prayer requests. May the Lord bless you. Please be seated, everybody. And the kids, Sunday school kids, can be dismissed to go downstairs. Praise God. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, everybody, for being bold to speak out and declare what God is speaking to you, praise God, and sharing that with all of us, hallelujah. I just want to read something from, Roberto was speaking and reading from John chapter 16, and I want to read from that same scripture because it speaks directly to what the Lord had given me to talk to you about this morning. And that is that in John 16, I just want to read a couple of verses here before I get to the actual message. But verse 13, and if you will, just try to keep this in your mind as we move on through this, and you'll see how the how the Holy Spirit is speaking to us. But verse 13 says, "Howbeit, when he, the Spirit of truth, is come, he will guide you into all truth, for he shall not speak of himself, but whatsoever he shall hear, that shall he speak, and he will," and here's a key word here, "he will show you," or shew you, "things to come." Drop down to verse 15. "All things that the Father hath are mine, therefore said I that he shall take of mine and shall show it unto you." Okay? Now, verse 25, "These things I have spoken unto you in Proverbs, but the time cometh when I shall no more speak unto you in Proverbs, but I shall show you plainly the Father." Yeah. And then verse 30, "Now are we sure that thou knowest all things, and needest not that any man should ask thee by this. We believe that thou camest forth from God. Now are we sure that thou knowest all things, and needest not that any man should ask thee. By this we believe that thou comest forth from God." Praise the Lord. So what I really want to talk to you about this morning is revelation and how it relates to the miraculous and the supernatural, the new creation. Amen. And when we think of the glory of God, the word glory actually is doxa is the Greek word. I'm not pronouncing it right, but it doesn't matter because none of you speak Greek anyway. Praise the Lord. I'm guessing. But it comes from the word dokeo, which also actually comes from the root word. Now, dokeo is the definition of that is to be accounted or to be made aware. Dakanu, which is the root word for glory, is to show. Now, you could then substitute that word in the language of the writer of the book of John, that Jesus is showing God. In other words, the glory he's doing, he's showing the glory of God. And he's giving them revelation at the same time, because they're saying, we don't get this, we don't understand it. How come he's talking in circles? Why didn't he just come out and say it plain? And then he does, and actually it's by the Spirit that this happens, that they say, now we know. How, all of a sudden you're speaking plainly to me. Amen? Because the Spirit is speaking directly to him. Amen? So with that in mind, just try to keep that in your head there. And let's go to Mark chapter 16, and we'll read verses 17 and 18. This is Jesus' commission, and it's valid. It's for us, each and every one of us today. And how many of you know people that don't believe this? You know what this is, right? It's these signs will follow them. So there are people, Christians, believers, people that are born again, who do not believe this. Why do they not believe it? Because it hasn't been shown to them. They haven't revelation of this. They haven't seen the glory of this. So they're operating in a lesser place, amen? Doesn't make it any less true, doesn't make it any less glorious, doesn't make it any less revelation, they just haven't got it, amen? So these signs will follow them that believe. In my name shall they cast out devils, they shall speak with new tongues, they shall take up serpents, and if they drink any deadly thing, it shall not hurt them. They shall lay hands on the sick, and they shall recover. Praise God. All right, now let's go to Psalms chapter 36. And I want to read verses 7 through 9. Psalms 36, 7 through 9. I do have a bunch of scriptures here, Sheila, so I'll try to get them to you accurately. And if you need an ace bandage for that wrist, just holler. So how excellent is thy loving kindness, O God. Therefore the children of men put their trust under the shadow of thy wings. They shall be abundantly satisfied with the fatness of thy house, and thou shalt make them drink of the river of thy pleasures. For with thee is the fountain of life, and thy light shall we see light. Praise God. So, we're talking about the glory of God, and talking about the importance of revelation as opposed to information. Or truth as opposed to fact.
Right.
So James 2:19. Pardon me if I'm spitting. I got a cough up here in my mouth. So thou believest that there is one God, thou doest well. The devil also believes and trembles. So believing in the existence of divine reality, whatever that is, however you define that, I'm not just talking about the existence of God, but the whole reality of God. So believing in that existence, even the divine reality of the Gospels, even of the Bible, doesn't mean you believe in a way that's going to do you any good. Demons know there's a gospel. They know the Bible. It's God's word. But they don't see revelation truth.
Right.
Praise God. Matthew 13:13.
Therefore speak I to them in parables, because they seeing see not, and hearing they hear not,
neither do they understand.
Right.
And that's true of every one of us until God gives us eyes to see. Ephesians chapter 1, verses 17 and 18, Doug.
The God of our Lord Jesus Christ, the Father of glory, may give unto you the spirit of wisdom and revelation in the knowledge of him, the eyes of your understanding being enlightened, that you may know what is the hope of his calling and what the riches of the glory of his inheritance in the saints. Now, you can just put revelation here, you know. What's the riches of the revelation of his inheritance? The awareness, the knowledge, the acceptance. You know, we talk about the glory, and it's a beautiful thing. But the truth is, we need to have a revelation of what it is God's done. And so we're not just looking for a glory cloud somewhere, but we're actually seeing and expecting the manifestation of that reality in our lives. And it only comes by revelation. It doesn't come by information. It doesn't come just because you read it or you heard somebody else talk about it, because if that were the case, the devils would all get saved.
Sure.
Hallelujah.
Amen. They have no revelation. They don't understand the glory of God or not able to perceive the glory of God. Amen. So, hallelujah. Revelation of inheritance. It's where we started in Mark chapter 16 when Jesus was talking to the disciples. It was by the Spirit. The Spirit was speaking. He was giving them revelation of who their, what their identity is now, what they're capable of, what is possible for them to do. It was glory being released, but they had to receive it as revelation.
Yes, Lord.
Amen. So revelation is for revelation. You've heard me say that before. The reason God gives us revelation is so we can get revelation.
Right.
Yes.
All right, just think of it in the natural. You know, the known is what determines your knowing.
Yeah.
I mean, you have to have some place to start.
Yeah.
Yep. So it's what you know that leads you to greater knowledge, right? To give you more, make it possible to know more. Revelation is the same way. Every revelation we get, there's a purpose behind it, and that's to take us to a greater revelation. Greater glory. We receive glory so that we can experience greater glory, so that God is glorified and we are getting the revelation or the revealing of that reality.
Yes.
Amen. So, if the glory of God in the gospel is what we have to know, then if that's what our faith is in, then the eyes to see this glory aren't the eyes in our head.
No.
But it's what Paul calls the eyes of our heart.
Yes.
Matthew 16, verses 16 and 17. Simon Peter answered and said, "Thou art the Christ, the Son of the living God." And Jesus answered and said unto him, "Blessed art thou, Simon Barjona, for flesh and blood hath not revealed it unto you, but my Father, which is in heaven." So there's a glory in the person of Jesus that's really there. I mean, it's reality. But we're blind to it apart from the gift of God. That's why we sit here as believers. And you can go out and look around the city and find plenty of people who are not believers. They can read the Bible. They probably have read it or at least heard about it. They know that there is this historic figure, at least, a prophet, somebody by the name of Jesus.
Right.
Amen. But they can't receive him as Messiah or Savior apart from the gift of God.
Right.
Unless God reveals it, unless they get revelation, unless they see the glory of God in Jesus, they don't get changed. They don't experience anything. Okay? So, Luke chapter 10, verses 21 and 22. In that hour, Jesus rejoiced in spirit and said, "I thank thee, O Father, Lord of heaven and earth, that thou hast hid these things from the wise and prudent, hath revealed them unto babes. Even so, Father, for so it seemed good in thy sight. All things are delivered to me of my Father, and no man knoweth who the Son is but the Father, and who the Father is but the Son, and he to whom the Son will reveal him." Praise God. So spiritual perception or understanding or revelation or glory is different than intellectual knowledge.
Absolutely.
They're not the same. You can know, but never experience.
Right.
Amen. You can have head knowledge without ever experiencing the glory or the revelation. Amen. The manifestation, if you will.
Yep.
With revelation, you don't just exercise rational thinking or rational ability, reasoning ability. Amen. But you also taste with spiritual ability.
Yes.
Praise God. Amen. Psalms 34, verse 8. Taste and see that the Lord is good.
Amen.
Obviously, we know he's not talking about take a bite out of Jesus. He's talking about something that goes beyond intellect.
Yes.
Something that's just
yes.
Glory, revelation. Amen. Oh, taste and see that the Lord is good. Blessed is the man that trusteth in him.
Yes.
All right. 1 Peter chapter 2, verses 2 and 3. having tasted. I'm looking at people here that have tasted the Lord.
Come on.
Yeah. And you haven't just hear about him. You haven't just read about him. You haven't just got a mental assent to the fact that he exists. You've actually tasted of the Lord. Amen. You know something that people that have never tasted God don't know. Amen. As newborn babes, desire the sincere milk of the word, that ye may grow thereby. If so be, ye have tasted that the Lord is gracious.
Yes. Hallelujah.
So revelation primarily consists of the tasting of divine things.
Yes.
Beginning with salvation, or even beginning with the awareness of God, and then on to salvation. So it's like you can describe chocolate to somebody, but they don't know chocolate until they taste it.
Amen.
Amen. You can talk about it all you want, and you can try to tell them how wonderful it is and how great you're going to love it. And even if you get a pimple or two, who cares? You know, just go ahead and eat some. It's worth it. That's why they got Clearasil, you know. Praise God. But they, until they have a bite, until they get a taste, they don't really know. They may think, well, it sounds really good, or, you know, I don't know, maybe I'll like it, maybe it'll upset my stomach, I don't know. But until they taste, they have no point of reference. They have no way of really relating to what it is you're trying to share with them. Amen? So 1 Corinthians chapter 2, verses 4 and 5, which is also the reason why God uses human beings. Somebody's got to give them a bite. Somebody has to, you know, somehow somebody has to get their senses stirred so that they want to taste.
Yes.
So that they'll open up so that the Spirit can then give them a taste of God. So they can have an experience rather than some knowledge.
Oh, yes.
My speech and my preaching was not with enticing words of man's wisdom, but in demonstration of the Spirit and of power, that your faith should not stand in the wisdom of men, but in the power of God. We've read that and believe that it has to be a miracle. I got to come out here and see somebody get slain in the Spirit, somebody get healed of something. Not saying any of that is not true or that it isn't valid, but that's not what he's talking about. He's talking about my speech and my preaching was not with enticing words of man's wisdom, but in the demonstration of the Spirit and of power. In other words, somehow I gave some people a taste of God. And all of a sudden, it became a reality because that... Your faith should not stand in the wisdom of men or in the knowledge of what your intellect can perceive, but in the power of God. Hallelujah. Yes. By revelation, by the glory of God.
Amen.
That's what Paul was giving. He was putting something out there for them to taste, amen, so they could have an experience, amen, of the a true experience of the power of God.
Yes.
Hallelujah. The gospel is the power of God unto salvation. And that is sozo, so it's not just salvation for escaping hell, but it's everything else that goes with it. Healing, deliverance, financial breakthrough, all of the things that God has promised us through the finished work of the cross, okay? So, this is 1 Corinthians chapter 2, verse 4 and 5. My speech, my preaching was not with enticing words. Amen? It was, I like that because it makes me feel a lot better, hallelujah, when I leave here a lot of times on Sundays and Wednesdays. I wonder if that made any sense to anybody. Hallelujah. All right, that's revelation, okay? Look at 2 Corinthians now, chapter 4, and I want to read verses 3 through 6. I'll just throw this out there, but what I'm saying here is for us to have a healing, you have to have revelation of healing.
Sure.
You have to taste and see that it's true, that God is good. Amen. And how do you do that? You do it. A lot of times we hear it's by focusing on Jesus. Well, you know, how do you do that? We've never seen him. Where do? We look up. We look at the cross. We look at something and we look at it. No, we look at the glory. We look at the revelation.
Yes.
Everything in this Bible is revelation, and it's all a revelation of Jesus Christ.
Yes.
You just have to dig a little deeper to find that they're talking about Jesus, but it's all about Jesus. And it's all because God is trying to give us greater revelation. So that there will be greater glory.
Yes.
So there will be more healing. So there will be more deliverance. So there will be more breakthrough. So there will be more people saved. So there will be more people walking in the reality of Christ in us,
yes,
the hope of glory.
Yes.
Praise the Lord. If we got Jesus in us, half of us don't even know what Jesus does.
Come on.
That's
a truth. Well, I wouldn't say half of us, but some of us. Praise God. And so we're struggling, amen, with a revelation And we're wondering why we're not getting any glory, why we're not seeing the glory, is because our revelation is distorted.
Right.
It's not pure, so the glory cannot be. But if our gospel's hid, it's hid to them that are lost. In whom the God of this world, and we've heard, that's what we've been talking about here this morning, the God of this world has blinded the minds of them which believe not, lest the light of the glorious gospel of Christ, who is the image of God, should shine unto them. For we preach not ourselves, but Christ Jesus the Lord, and ourselves, your servants, for Jesus' sake. For God, who commanded the light to shine out of darkness, has shined in our hearts to give the light of the knowledge of the glory of God in the face of Jesus Christ. You say revelation.
Come on.
Praise the Lord. Amen. So, notice, it's interesting to me that how similar verse 4 and verse 6 are in terms of the way they're worded. In verse 4, Satan blinds. God of this world has blinded the minds of them which believe not. Right?
Mm-hmm.
In verse 6, God enlightens.
Yes.
So the devil blinds, God opens eyes.
Yes.
But the language is very similar.
Yes.
Amen?
Yes.
So the thing that Satan hides from us in verse 4 is what God enables us to see in verse 6.
Yes.
Come on.
So unbelievers see facts of the gospel.
Mm-hmm.
See words, they see verbs, they see the language, but they don't see the light of the gospel in the glory of Jesus Christ. They have no revelation. They just got information.
Right.
Yep.
Praise the Lord. Now, when the gospel's read or when the gospel's preached, they see facts, but they see no glory. They got no revelation.
That's right.
They've got information.
Sure.
But information, everybody gets to choose.
Sure.
I'll accept it. I won't accept it. It's true. It's false. It's fact. It's fiction. But revelation cannot be argued with.
No.
Revelation, you taste.
Yes.
You know.
Yep.
It's done, right? So back to 2 Corinthians, Sheila, 4, verses 4 through 6. In whom the God of this world hath blinded the minds of them which believe not, lest the light of the glorious gospel of Christ, who is the image of God, should shine unto them. For we preach not ourselves, but Christ Jesus the Lord, and ourselves your servants for Jesus' sake. For God, who commanded the light to shine out of darkness, has shined in our hearts to give the light of the knowledge of the glory of God in the face of Jesus Christ. Amen. And so if you can back up to chapter 3, verse 18. 2 Corinthians 3, 18. We're looking in a mirror, you know, we all with open face beholding as in a glass the glory of the Lord are changed into the same image from glory to glory, from revelation to revelation. We all with open face beholding as in a glass the revelation of God are changed unto that image from glory to glory, from revelation to revelation, even as by the Spirit of the Lord.
Yes.
Amen. You don't get it by just reading more. You don't get it by just praying more. You get it by God. You get it by the Spirit. You get it by the Spirit of God. Amen? So that comes from the Lord, who is the Spirit.
Right.
The one who declares the glory of Christ as the Lord. We got to see that revelation. You have to see that glory. And according to Paul, you can't see the glory of Christ and not be transformed. You can't have revelation and not be changed. You can't taste and see that the Lord is good and have it not impact you. Not if you have revelation, if you know what, and I know you do, we're sitting here talking about it. So if you do, you cannot have that and not be transformed. It's an internal thing, but eventually it will be exposed externally. There will be manifestation, amen, but it's a true thing, amen. So beholding is being transformed. Beholding the glory, we are transformed.
Yes.
Receiving revelation changes you.
Yes.
Divine illumination or revelation or God's glory.
Mm-hmm.
It's all one and the same. 2 Corinthians chapter 4, verse 6.
And the light shines, amen, revelation comes, for God who commanded the light to shine out of darkness has shined in our hearts to give the light of the knowledge of the glory of God in the face
of Jesus Christ. So, I want you to notice this. Acts chapter 26, in relation to this, Acts chapter 26, verses 17 and 18.
Delivering thee from the people and from the Gentiles unto whom now I send thee, to open their eyes and to turn them from darkness to light, from the power of Satan unto God, that they may receive forgiveness of sins and inheritance among them which are sanctified by faith that is in me.
Now, this is what I was referring to earlier about God needs a human.
Right.
To release the glory, to let the revelation out there, to give them the taste, right?
Right.
Because Paul knew 2 Corinthians 4 and 6 and Ephesians 1:17, where we just read a few minutes ago, they show that God is the one giving revelation or spiritual insight, right?
Right.
But here, Jesus is telling Paul to go do what only God can do.
Yeah.
You got to have revelation to give revelation.
Yes.
Right.
You got to know the truth to speak the truth.
Right.
You got to have light to be a light bearer. Don't let your light hide. Don't hide your light. He's not talking about good deeds so much as he is talking about revelation. Share your revelation. Get it out there.
Amen.
Because it increases you. It makes you susceptible to greater revelation.
Amen.
We haven't arrived. And revelation will be revelation throughout eternity. We'll continue to have revelation throughout eternity, never coming to the totality of God. Amen. We need to understand we have not arrived. And just like we can look at somebody back here in another denomination who doesn't believe in healing or deliverance because they don't have revelation, they haven't tasted it to know that it's true, they haven't been exposed to it because nobody's going to share it with them if they don't believe it.
Uh-huh.
We struggle with the same things. Amen. Okay, let me just say it like this. And I'm not saying this to be, you know, elevating one person over another. It's just a fact. I have a revelation of healing. Why? Because I've been healed.
Amen.
I've tasted and seen the Lord. He is a healer.
Amen.
Yes.
Jane can testify.
Yes.
I've been healed.
Absolutely.
I've tasted.
Absolutely.
And I know. I have revelation of healing. Why? Because I've experienced it. I've tasted it. I know it. I've had it. Now, we can have knowledge of it. But it doesn't necessarily mean we're experiencing it. It doesn't necessarily mean we have real revelation of it.
Yes.
Hallelujah. We need to operate in revelation. We need to operate in the glory of God. And that is in the person of Jesus Christ.
Yes.
He is your healer. He's a revelation of healing.
Yes.
Because he's the healer. God is a revelation of love. Why? Because God is love.
Yes.
Not everybody knows God as a lover. A lot of them know him as a judge. Why? Because they've never tasted, amen, the grace and the goodness and the mercy of God.
Amen.
It's not glorious to them. It's not revelation to them. It's just somebody else's information that's being passed along. So, Satan unto God, that they may receive the forgiveness of sins, to open their eyes and to turn them from darkness to light and from the power of Satan unto God, that they may receive forgiveness of sins and inheritance among them which are sanctified by faith, by the way that's in him. Praise the Lord.
Yes.
So, God has chosen to make human witness critical in leading people to God.
Mm-hmm.
Now,
we say... I can't save a person. But Don said earlier, I have authority to forgive people.
Yes.
Jesus said, which is harder? To say you're forgiven or to say you're healed?
Yeah.
It's the same. It takes God to do it.
Exactly.
Right.
We have Christ in us. He said, you have this authority.
Woo.
You have this power.
Yes.
You've been given authority. You've been given dominion.
Yes.
Oh, it's one thing to say it, it's another thing to have a revelation of it.
Sure.
It's one thing to say it, it's another thing to experience the glory of it.
Right.
Because the glory of it reveals God, it reveals Christ, it reveals the reality of God in us. Amen?
Amen.
So that somebody can taste it. so somebody else can experience it. Praise God. All right, 2 Timothy chapter 2, verse 25, and I'll show you another little kind of way of looking at that same thing. Paul's talking to Timothy, this young preacher, and he says, in meekness, instructing those that oppose themselves, if God peradventure will give them repentance to the acknowledging of the truth. So, in meekness, not, look, here's what I know, you don't know it. You know, you need me so I can tell you how stupid you are. No, in meekness, instructing those that oppose themselves. How many of you know we have Christ in us, we are one with God. When we don't receive healing, when we don't believe that we're going to be healed or that we can be healed, we're opposing ourselves at the same time we're opposing God. I'm not talking about punishment's going to come as a result of this. That's not what I'm saying. You're already being punished because you're stuck.
Yep.
You're stuck in a condition you're not supposed to have.
Exactly.
You got an issue or a situation that God has given you deliverance from.
Exactly.
Amen. He wants to reveal his glory in you. He wants to give revelation to you so that you can be revelation.
Yes, Lord.
So that you can be a carrier of the Shekinah, of the glory, of the weightiness, of the reality of God.
Amen.
Not just as some figment of somebody's imagination, but a tangible reality.
Amen.
Praise the Lord. So in meekness, instructing those who oppose themselves, if God peradventure will give them repentance to the acknowledging of the truth. Repentance is not, oh, I'm so sorry, I'm such a jerk. No, it's changed my mind about what's true and what isn't.
Yeah.
Not only about God, but about everything else.
Yes.
What God's glory is all about, what God's doing in our lives, what God wants to do in our lives. Amen?
Amen.
We don't have final control. We don't have final say. But cheer up. Have hope. Because God does.
Yeah.
Amen? And we know it's not his will that any should perish, but that all should come to repentance. We know it's not his will that people suffer with diabetes, that suffer with cancer, that suffer with heart disease and financial crisis and dysfunction and all the other things that go on. That's not the will of God. How's it going to change? Somebody got to get a revelation that we are the ones that make the change. We are the ones who carry the chocolates. Taste and see that the Lord is good. Praise God. 2 Corinthians 4 and 6 again. I mean, we ought to be bold. What do we got to lose? You know, I embarrass myself at least once a day. And that's because I'm not out a lot. The more I embarrass myself. I say stupid stuff. I don't think sometimes when I talk. I don't know what I'm talking about sometimes. I just figure if I talk long enough, I'll say something. But I don't, you know, I catch myself in the middle of a conversation. This may sound, you know, schizophrenic or something, but I catch myself in the middle of conversations all the time wondering what it is we're talking about. Sorry. I mean, you know, I'm with it, and then I'm all of a sudden I get distracted. Something's going through my mind that I'm thinking I got to take care of this. And I'm looking the person in the eye, and I'm thinking, oh, my God, I don't know what you just said.
Yes.
I hope you weren't waiting for an answer.
Yeah.
So, I'm just saying, it happens. It happens. In whom the God of this world has blinded the minds of them which believe not, lest the light of the glorious gospel of Christ, who is the image of God, should shine unto them. For we preach not ourselves, but Christ Jesus the Lord, and ourselves your servants for Jesus' sake. For God, who commanded the light to shine out of darkness, has shined, amen, in our hearts to give the light of the knowledge of the glory of God in the face of Jesus Christ. Now, I got to read that again. I mean, think about it. For God, he commanded the light to shine out of darkness, shine into our hearts, to give the light of the knowledge of the glory of God in the face of Jesus Christ. So I'm guessing that you. Amen. You are the church. You are the body of Christ. Hallelujah. We carry that anointing. We carry that glory, that revelation. And we need to stay focused on it for ourselves, first of all, and so that then we can share the chocolate with somebody else. But I can't share something I don't have.
Come on.
If I haven't tasted and known that God is good. It's hard for me to convince anybody else that God is good. That's why we have to behold that glory. We have to keep that focus of the revelation of God and every revelation in this Bible.
Yes.
Amen. The revelation for healing, the revelation for deliverance, the revelation of Christ in you, the hope of glory, the revelation of God being revealed through us. God grants repentance. See, it's like what God did the first day of creation. He says, let light shine. So that person that's trapped in darkness suddenly sees the glory of God. God grants repentance so the captive of Satan is freed from blindness.
Yes.
And he comes to their senses and see the truth. Come to the knowledge of the truth.
Yes.
The glory of God in Christ comes to revelation. From demonic stupor, blindness, to their senses. Sees truth. And this, it pervades the entire Bible. It's throughout the scripture. So what's it like to experience the miracle of 2 Corinthians chapter 4, verse 6? God who commanded the light to shine out of darkness has shined in our hearts to give the light of the knowledge of the glory of God in the face of Jesus Christ. Go back to Psalms chapter 36, verse 9. So, yeah. God is everywhere. He's in the darkness. We don't have to be afraid of the dark. He's there. But he's not darkness. He's light. But even in the darkness, he's there. David said, if I make my bed in hell, he's there. If I go as high as I can get, he's there. Wherever I go, the deep of the sea, God's there. Amen. But he says, how excellent is thy loving kindness, O God. Therefore the children of men put their trust under the shadow of thy wings. Verse 9, for with thee is the foundation of life. In thy light shall we see light. Now, he's not talking about incandescent bulbs or any other kind of light. He's talking about truth. He's talking about revelation.
Yes.
He's talking about glory.
Yes.
Amen. With thee is the fountain of life. In thy light shall we see light. In that first revelation, he said, you know, here's the beginning of knowledge, the beginning of wisdom. There's a God. Okay, that's some revelation. That's revelation, believe it or not. Not everybody believes there's a God. So God had to give you that. Why did he give you that? So that then you could know how much more there is to this God.
Yes.
God is, and he's a rewarder of those who continually seek revelation.
Yep.
He'll give you more revelation.
Yes.
Amen. He'll give you a greater glory of God.
Yes.
A greater experience in God. A greater taste of God.
Yes.
Hallelujah. The light that we've got in the world doesn't shine on him. See, that's what religion does. It tries to put a spotlight on Jesus.
Right.
But the light that we've got in the world doesn't shine on him and reveal his truth. He is the light of the world.
Yes.
And in his light, we see light.
Yes.
See, without him, everything is crazy.
Right.
Everything's chaotic. It makes no sense. It's what the scripture says. Everything's upside down. The servants are on horseback and the princes are leading the horses.
Right.
What's good is bad. What's bad is good. He's the light of the world. And in his light, we see light.
Mm-hmm.
Acts chapter 17. Verse 28. Just teach it this morning. So just let this get in you. Get it. Let it just bounce around in you until it makes sense to you, okay? For in him we live and move and have our being. As certain also of your own poets have said, for we are also his offspring.
Mm-hmm.
All right, Romans chapter 11, verse 36. For of him and through him and to him are all things, to whom be glory forever. Amen. So he's the origin. He's the source. If we have any measure of light whatsoever, it's him that's shedding the light on whatever we're seeing, and not us.
Exactly.
Not some man. I mean, thank God for preachers and teachers and witnesses and everybody else, but the truth is, you can hear the best, you can hear the worst, you can hear the nobodies, you can hear the everybodies, the somebodies, but unless God reveals it, you aren't getting squat.
That's right.
You get some information, but that doesn't change anything.
Nope.
How many of you know? I mean, I've sat in church services where I didn't like the guy that was preaching. I mean, I sat there and thought, you know, I don't even want to listen to this guy. Seriously, I know that sounds like I'm a horrible person, but it's true. We have our tastes, and some of us lean more to one thing or the other. But I mean, I've been in somewhere I thought I can't listen to this person. I can't stand the sound of their voice. I can't stand their gestures. I just don't like what they're doing. You know, I know it's hideous, but that's true. But I get revelation.
Sure.
Huh? Yeah, I was in a Methodist church in Ankeny years ago. Mm-hmm. I got some of the best, some of the most powerful revelation on the oneness of God or the unity of God. Mm-hmm. I'm not here to debate all that. I'm just saying of how God exists within himself from a man who had no clue what he was even talking about.
Sure.
I mean, I know he did it because I talked to him afterwards. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
Have you ever done that? I know some of you have done it to me, and you ask me, I'm looking at you like a, you know, cow looking at a new gate. I don't know what you're talking about because I don't even know what I said. You know, I know what was in my notes, but I don't know what actually came out of my mouth. And so something resonated with you,
uh-huh.
Not because of so much about what I was saying, but because of what God was trying to say to you. So you can talk to three or four people in the same service and ask them about the message, and you'll get three or four different messages.
Come on.
Why? Because the Holy Spirit is dealing with them with this truth, with this glory, with this revelation. Amen. All he needs is some idiot to get up there and get the chocolates out.
Yes.
Right? I mean, he doesn't need my intellect. He doesn't need my wisdom. He just needs somebody to open their mouth so that he has access, amen, to share his wisdom or his revelation with us.
Yes.
We don't have to be afraid. When we witness with people and we're sharing with people, just be yourself and share, and God will get to them what he wants to get to them, even if it doesn't come out of your mouth.
Amen.
He just needs that human contact. He needs somebody to be there to present the Holy Spirit to them so they can get revelation, so they can get glory and the glory of God revealed to them. Amen? Hallelujah. So, he's the origin. He's the source. It's him that's shedding the light, not us. John chapter 1, verses 1 through 9. John 1, 1 through 9. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. The same was in the beginning with God. All things were made by him, and without him was not anything made that was made. In him was life, and the life was the light of men. His life is the only, it is the revelation. It's the beginning, it's the end. It's the Alpha, the Omega, right?
Yep.
Everything within that. So, and the light shineth in darkness, and the darkness comprehended it not. That says, by his stripes you were healed, but it says he is the healer.
Yes.
It's not just an act that he performed, or not just a function that he performed, or not just a sacrifice that he made, but that's his reality. That's who he is. Now, just think about it. Get that revelation. How can you not be healed if you have that revelation living in you?
Come on.
And the light shineth in darkness, and the darkness comprehended it not. That's how.
Right.
He said he wants you to be all light. Let your light shine. Don't hide it under a bushel. If you got some, share it.
Come on.
And expect more. The light shineth in darkness, the darkness comprehended it not. But there was a man sent from God whose name was John. The same came for a witness to bear witness of the light, that all men through him might believe. He wasn't the light, but he was sent to bear witness of the light. That was the true light, which lighteth every man that cometh into the world.
Yes.
Yeah. Praise God. Verse 14. We beheld it. What? What did we behold? His glory. We got a revelation. We read it at the very beginning.
Yes.
What was the revelation? We've been listening to parables. We've been listening to these stories, and they don't make sense to us. All of a sudden, by the Spirit, he speaks, and they go, now we know. You are who you said you are. You did come from God. So the Word was made flesh and dwelt among us. We beheld his glory, the glory as of the only begotten of the Father, full of grace and truth. We got the revelation. There was a whole world of people who didn't get the revelation. To him, he was a prophet. To them, he was, a rebel, a problem, a troublemaker. But to those whom God gave revelation, they immediately recognized him as their Messiah,
yes,
as God in the flesh.
Right.
Now, if you notice, the Jews and others who rejected Christ as their Messiah never received the baptism of the Holy Spirit.
Right.
I'm just saying, without the revelation of him, you can't move to the next one.
Right.
And it's just as simple to say, without that revelation, you can't move on to healing. You can't move on to deliverance. You can't move on to financial breakthrough. You can't move on to dysfunctional relationship. None of that's, it's not going to happen. It isn't a crapshoot. You know, you don't get up one day and just roll the dice and say, well, today I think I'll believe in this. You may want to believe it. You may hope that it's true. But unless it's revealed to you by the Spirit, you don't get it. You'll struggle with it. And I can't tell you how many times, and probably all of us have done this. You sit down and you talk to people and you think, my God, what is it? What is so stupid about me that I can't explain this in a way that they can understand it? Because I'm not that bright, and yet I get it. Why? Only because God revealed it. Only because I, somehow, some way, somewhere, back in time, somewhere, I said yes to that revelation, and God said, here, try this.
Yeah.
If you think that's good, try some of this.
Yeah.
Right.
Come on.
But if I hadn't come to that place, that initial place of revelation, I'd still be in the darkness. The light would just blind me, and I'd turn away from it.
Mm-hmm.
Whoever's back there, you're staying until the service. The Word was made flesh, dwelt among us, and we beheld his glory, the glory as begotten of the Father, full of grace and truth. Amen. So the light, get this, the light entered the light that he had created.
Yes.
Hallelujah.
Come on.
He's the one that can be known and the one who makes all knowing possible.
Uh-huh.
Just those two things almost give me a headache. Because it's so simple,
sure,
and yet it's true.
Yes.
Amen.
He that spoke light comes and goes into the light.
Yes, yes.
Amen.
Now, here's it, just for the sake of saying it. He enlightens us, and we say, there is a God. Light has come.
Yes.
Mm-hmm.
And what happens? He steps into the light. Born again. A new creation.
Yes.
Based on the same format,
yes,
of the original creation.
Uh-huh.
God releases revelation, then he steps into the revelation himself.
Yes.
Amen.
Yes.
He releases revelation to us to believe that he is, and then he steps right into that human being.
Uh-huh.
So that their life is nothing but one continuous revelation, if they'll focus on Christ in you, the hope of glory. You know, we ought to see a lot of divergence. You know, we get nervous when people don't agree with us completely.
Exactly.
We ought to understand that we're never meant for everybody to be in sync completely, because not everybody is in the same place in terms of revelation. Doesn't make him bad. Doesn't make one greater than the other, because as I said, there's no light except his light. It's not my light being reflected. It's his light or no light.
Right.
So nobody gets to, God gave me this, and I know all this stuff. You don't know sick of it. I mean, if it wasn't God releasing it, you wouldn't have anything.
Right.
So just thank God for the light. Thank God for the light you've got. And what light you do have, share.
Yes.
And trust God.
Amen.
Who knows the hearts of men.
Yes.
To reveal to them.
Amen.
What they're ready to have revealed to them. Where they're ready to step out. Because God doesn't like to give and take. He wants to give and then give some more. Matthew 16:16. Again, this is Peter. Thou art the Christ, the Son of the living God, right? How did this dud figure this out? I mean, this is a sinner. This is a liar. This is a deceiver. It's all about me. Imperfect, sinful. How did he see Jesus for who he really was? Verse 17. Mm-hmm. Jesus answered and said, Blessed art thou, Simon Bar-Jonah, because flesh and blood have not revealed it unto you, but my Father which is in heaven.
Amen.
Praise God.
Lord.
Jesus, it was his way of saying what Paul said in 2 Corinthians 4 and 6, 2 Timothy 2:25, and Ephesians 1:17, namely, God has to open the eyes of our heart before the glory of God in Christ, or revelation, can be seen for what it really is.
Yes.
If you'll step out in revelation, you'll get more revelation.
Come on.
Now, God is dealing with this, and I don't want to get way off in this, but God is dealing with the body now for us to walk the life. I'm not talking about sinless perfection. I'm talking about being who we are in Christ.
Yes.
Naturally.
Exactly.
Sharing the truth naturally. Not
yes.
Not weird, not bizarre, but just as we are, who we are, what we are, where we are.
Yes.
That's revelation. And I believe it's been God's intent from the very beginning. But you don't get to operate in revelation unless you receive the revelation.
Sure.
We've been so focused on religion and fixing up the outside of this thing that we've never understood this is all about the inside coming out. And if we don't get that understanding, nothing's going to change. And whatever is on the outside is just a big fake.
Yep. Yep.
And certainly it seems that way to other people. Because it's not revelation. If it's not revelation, it's just more information. And God knows we live in an information-focused society. There's plenty of information out there. I'm sick of information.
Come on.
I don't even watch the news hardly, except I watch the weather just so I'll have a laugh.
Yeah. Yeah.
Praise God.
Yeah.
I want revelation. I've got so much information that I can't do anything with.
Come on.
Can't do a thing about the information that I have. But revelation, you can change the world.
Absolutely.
You can change your world. And you can change the world wherever you are in that world. That's God's intent.
Yes.
Revelation needs to be seen for what it is. Luke chapter 8, verse 10. And he said unto you, it is given to know the mysteries of the kingdom of God, but to others in parables, that seeing they might not see, and hearing they might not understand. Does that ever bother anybody when you read that? He said unto you, it's given to know the mysteries of the kingdom of God, but to others, it's in parables. It's information. It's not revelation. It's just more information. Maybe information they can understand in terms of the parable, because it's something they can relate to, but it's not revelation.
Right.
That seeing they might not see. and hearing they might not understand. That's how everybody comes to revelation.
Right.
You search the scriptures, for in them you think you'll find eternal life. But they're what's talking about me. And yet you won't come to the revelation. You just want more information. You keep searching the scripture. You keep reading the scriptures. He's talking to the Jews who were the keepers of the Bible, of the Torah. And they kept searching, and they kept searching, and they kept searching, but they never came to the truth. Why? No revelation. Why? Because they rejected the first revelation.
Sure.
Praise God. Matthew chapter 11, verse 25 and 27. I'm just saying this. You want revelation? How about living on the edge? How about living dangerously? How about living with risk? I'm serious. No risk, no reward. No pain, no gain. You know those cliches? If you're not willing to step out in faith, you just might as well plan on being in the same place you are right now up until the time you leave. So I'm not afraid of risk. I mean, I'm not afraid that we're going to do something wrong. I'm afraid we won't do anything.
There you go.
You know, it's like... I think that it's true to form. Millard Fillmore. How many of y'all read a lot about his presidency? Well, his theory was this: if I don't do anything, I won't do anything wrong. And that's why we don't know anything about Millard Fillmore. He wasn't willing to take a risk. He wasn't willing to take a chance. He wasn't willing to do anything outside of what he was totally comfortable with. And so his presidency just went. And he's just a spot somewhere on somebody's timeline and nothing more. I said here a couple weeks ago, and I don't see this egotistically, but I don't want to be remembered as just a dot on a timeline.
Right.
Amen.
I'd like to be remembered as somebody that Jesus loved.
Yes.
And somebody that loved Jesus.
Yes.
Not, I don't want to be remembered necessarily for my religion or my, you know, beliefs or this or my great faith or anything else. That's about as good as you can get. People, if they would remember me and say, well, he loved the Lord. I didn't understand much about him, but he seemed to really love the Lord, right? And obviously the Lord loved him.
Mm-hmm.
That's what's important.
Amen.
That'll change things. Amen? I thank thee, O Father, Lord of heaven and earth, because thou hast hid these things from the wise and the prudent and hast revealed them unto babes, even so the Father. For so it seemed good in your sight. Amen? Praise God. Judas saw the same Jesus that Peter saw. He was with him just as long, spent just as much time with him, saw all the miracles, all the same stuff, but he had absolutely zero revelation. He had all the same information everybody else had, but he didn't have any revelation.
Right.
He was blind to divine glory.
Yes.
Right.
John chapter 3, verses 19 and 20. And this is the condemnation, that light has come into the world, and men love darkness rather than light, because their deeds were evil. For everyone that doeth evil hateth the light, neither cometh to the light, lest his deeds should be reproved. Now, it's obvious, I mean, it's a given that we'd know this would be people who are, you know, atheists or antichrist or, you know, non-believers or angry at, you know, God or for whatever reason. But this is talking about people who claim to know God but don't know God.
Right.
This is the condemnation, that lights come into the world and men love darkness rather than light because their deeds were evil. Because everyone that doeth evil hateth the light, neither cometh to the light, lest his deeds should be reproved. Now, I'm not talking about, you know, you went out and got drunk. You slapped your dog or something, you know, or you just were mean or evil or whatever. That's not the issue. Praise the Lord. I venture to say there were some drunks at that wedding that Jesus was making more wine for. I mean, they went on for days. It wasn't like a wine tasting party. It was like a wine drinking party. It wasn't, I'll take a piece of bread now to cleanse my palate. No, it was pass the Mogan David or hand me the Boone's Farm or whatever, and let's keep this thing keeping on, right? Everyone that doeth evil hateth the light, neither cometh to the light, lest his deeds should be reproved. Amen? So the root of people's blindness isn't that they're victims of darkness, but they're lovers of darkness. They love the darkness of doing things their way, according to their religion. The flesh, exactly. Intellect. What seemeth right in their own eyes. Matthew 5 and 8 says, blessed are the pure in heart, for they shall see God. Somebody with a pure heart. Eyes of the heart. Someone who sees by the Spirit and not by the flesh. Praise God.
Amen.
2 Corinthians 4, again, verses 4 through 6, and we'll wrap it up right here. Praise the Lord. 2 Corinthians 4. 4 through 6, in whom the God of this world has blinded the minds of them which believe not, lest the light of the glorious gospel of Christ, who is the image of God, should shine unto them. For we preach not ourselves, but Christ Jesus the Lord, and ourselves your servants for Jesus' sake. For God, who commanded the light to shine out of darkness, has shined in our hearts to give the light of the knowledge of the glory of God in the face of Jesus Christ. So God imparts to our hearts the light of the knowledge of the glory of God in the face of Jesus Christ. That's the path to every revelation. Amen. God reveals Jesus, and in him we find that we live and breathe and move and have our being. It's in him that we taste and see that the Lord is good. It's in him that we find healing. It's in him that we find deliverance. It's in him that we find financial breakthrough. It's in him that we find restoration and all things.
Yes.
Every revelation works the same way. The light of the glory of the gospel of Jesus Christ. Amen.
Amen.
We have people that need healing. I'm standing up here preaching healing with snot running out of my nose, forgive me, mucus, and, coughing. And hey, but I see the glory. I mean, I see the reality. I see the truth. I know the revelation.
Yeah.
And I'm declaring that. I don't care what the symptoms are.
Right.
Amen.
It's easy to give in to the symptoms.
Right.
And it's what we do. If the circumstance is so outrageous, we can't seem to get control over it, we flip out. If the symptoms of your health condition are so outrageous that you can't get your focus off of those symptoms, you never get past it.
Right.
Without the revelation of the fact that you were healed, you're not going to get healed.
Right.
It's the known that leads us to knowing.
Yes.
It's revelation that leads us to revelation. Jesus is the perfect revelation of God. How many of you think it would be a good thing to have a good revelation of that and keep that revelation, keep that focus on the glory of God and see how revelation grows within us?
Yes.
And again, you don't have to just wake up one morning and go, wow, I get it. It's in you if you will just act on it.
Yeah.
You don't need the intellectual affirmation. You have the witness of the Spirit. You've tasted, so step out.
Yep.
Risk. Trust and see,
yes,
that he'll back you up. He's got your back.
Yeah.
And just imagine when you do that, we have no idea in this life what kind of revelation we can receive. The church could be light years ahead if they had revelation, if they'd have kept building on the revelation that Martin Luther had, for example, or any other revelation that came along throughout time. But because whatever revelation they got They chewed on that revelation, refused to receive any further revelation, and got stuck in the revelation they were in. And that's why we got 50,000 denominations now, and none of them know what they're talking about.
Woo.
Amen. I mean, not in totality.
Yeah.
Eye hath not seen, ear has not heard, and we're talking about the spiritual eye and the spiritual ear have not even imagined what kind of revelation God wants to reveal to us. What kind of glory God would like to see, amen, in this world.
Come on.
Amen.
Yes.
And I, for one, I'm not planning on leaving until I get some of that.
Come on.
Until I experience some of it. That's the hunger we should have.
Yes.
Praise God.
Yes.
That's the path to every revelation and every manifestation of God's promise. I don't care if it's healing, if it's, I don't care what it is, manifestation of a promise that you're looking for, this is the only way to it.
Yep.
He is the fountain of life, or the foundation of life. Everything works from there.
Yes.
Everything. You don't just read about healing and now, praise God, I get healed all the time. It doesn't work that way. You get into a bind, and you start looking for a revelation. You start looking for the glory of God. You can define it however you want to, but it ultimately becomes revelation. And what you do is expose yourself.
Sure.
You say, God, what do you want to do? I know you can do it. And then God says, stand on the Bible and walk around the room. Or, you know, I mean, I don't know what he'll say, but he'll give you some revelation, amen, that you didn't have before, because he wants you to taste and see.
Yes.
An aspect that you have not experienced yet. Once you've had it, never can be taken away from you.
That's right.
Come on.
Amen. Revelation cannot be stolen. Information, they can be twisted and manipulated, and that's why you've got people going from this particular denomination to that one, and to this one, and to that one, and to another one, because they're getting different information, and they're thinking, oh, that makes sense, maybe I'll try that. If they had revelation, they could sit anywhere. Because they'd be like David, they have no need of a teacher anymore. I'm being led by the Holy Spirit. He is the teacher. Amen? A fountain of life. In thy light, we see light. How many people born again are living in darkness? They're near the light. But it's in that light that we see light.
Mm-hmm.
It's in the revelation of him that all revelation comes. And that's what they're talking in general terms when they say, you know, when this trial comes or that trial, focus on Jesus. We're talking about focusing on the glory of God that manifested itself, that revealed itself in Christ and now is in you. Focus on the light that's in you. Focus on the God that is in you. Watch him shed light.
Amen.
Greater light.
Amen.
Amen. We are the people of light.
Yes.
We need to light up. Amen.
Amen.
Give the Lord a hand clap. Amen. Amen. God bless all of you. Appreciate your patience. Amen. Get out there and let your light shine. Get on the edge. Praise the Lord. You're dismissed in Jesus' name.